Hey family, it's Pastor Carrie here, and welcome back for your 15-minute daily devotion. If you are joining us for the first time, I want to extend a warm welcome to you. I'm so glad that you are here. And if you're my family that has been with us for the last several months with these 15-minute devotionals, I'm always glad that you are here. You all know that I like for you to like this. I want you to share it, and I want you to comment, because it helps us to know that these moments together bless you, that they inspire you, and that they push you to grow to a greater space. You know that this incredible experience is brought to you by none other than what I believe is the greatest church on the planet, which is New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, pastored by none other than Dr. Jamal H. Bryant. Listen, I have so much that I want to share with you today, but I want to make sure that you stay connected with the ministry, and you can do that by going to newbirth.org. I also want to remind you, for those who are our regular family, I want to remind you, and for those who are joining us for the first time, we are in the middle of a campaign, our 365 campaign, and you can find the prompts below, where we are believing that God can change everything that has happened over the year in one day. We're believing that he can do that, and we are preparing for a huge celebration in order to sacrifice and give incredible seed at levels that we've never given it before, and it's coming up at the first Sunday in November. So listen, I want to make sure that you have a chance to become a part of that. You can use the prompts below to get involved, to get engaged, and to make sure that you are pledging your seed. Listen, today I want to talk to you really by asking you the question, who's in your crew? Who's in your crew? Are you choosing your connections wisely? Listen, I was invited to a conference that I had such an incredible time at a couple of weeks ago, virtually, albeit, but we had a wonderful time. And this was one of the areas that I was called upon to talk about. It moved me so that I said, I want to be able to share this with my New Birth family, because I believe that we've got to evaluate who is in our crew. And most importantly, we've got to know how to choose our connections wisely. As we live in the middle of a global pandemic, COVID-19, we are in the middle of economic crises and so many different things that are happening in our world around us. One of the things that it has caused all of us to do, I hope, is evaluate where we are in life, and most importantly, who are we connected to and why do we have those connections? Listen, it was a very interesting topic for me when I first began to look at it, because for me, I never believed or felt like I belonged to a crew. For a good portion of my life, even when I was around groups of people, large groups of people, I always felt very much alone. So if you are like me, you might be around people, but you still can feel alone. You still can feel misunderstood, and you can still feel like an outcast in the middle of people. I never really felt like I could really connect with people in ways that I could totally understand them. And then in turn, I didn't feel like they could totally understand me. Now, this is not to say that I do not or I have not had incredible friends in my life, because I absolutely do. But what this is to say is that you can have people who walk very closely to you, and you can still feel like those people don't even fully know you, which can cause you to engage them only at a certain level, which makes you keep them on the periphery of your heart, because you might feel like it's safe only to let people get so close to you, especially when you love them. And then you begin to think, if I can keep them on the periphery of my heart, if I can keep them at a distance, especially because I love them, and out of the innermost spaces of who I am, if they do something to hurt me, if they do something to break my heart, the damage might not be as bad. The trauma might not be as bad. It might not hurt so much if I can keep them on the outside, on the periphery of my heart. And because of this, I began to identify myself as a loner. This is what I called myself. And I got to be honest and tell you, to this day, in some ways, I still describe myself this way. Listen, to describe the fact that I spend a great deal of time alone. I know that this might be hard to believe for many of you, because although I have a calling that requires me to be extremely extroverted, I am truly a very introverted person. And can I tell you, the older I get, the worse it becomes. I am very shy. Sometimes I feel like I am publicly awkward. Now, I can talk, I can have conversations, but if you put me in a forced environment, I'm uncomfortable. If you put me in an environment with a group of people and I have to talk or network or work the room, listen, I'm gonna be in the same spot that you left me when we got there, because I am extremely an introverted and shy person when it comes to public spaces. The truth is, 80% of the time or more, I am by myself. I spend a great deal of time alone. Now, let me tell you, I'm very comfortable with being alone. I like me. I enjoy my time by myself. I can eat alone. I go to restaurants alone. When the movies were open, I would go to the movies alone. Listen, you name it, I was never really shy or embarrassed to be able to do it alone. Listen, while it is perfectly okay to enjoy yourself and to spend time alone, what I needed to do was to begin to examine why I operate this way. And what I found was, when I was honest with myself, when I was truly transparent with myself, I found that I was not always this way. This isn't how I always lived. What I realized is that there were a series of events that happened in my life that created hurt and pain. This hurt came from people that I wanted in some way to be in connection or relationship with. And so in turn, this level of hurt fostered a spirit of rejection in me. And because rejection without proper processing can be detrimental, it caused me to close myself off from truly wanting to pursue friendships, truly wanting to pursue connections that could be painful. Anything that I thought would get too close to my heart, that would create hurt or pain for me, I created a wall against them. I realized that when I began examining this, I went back even all the way to my childhood. And I remember being in a class when I was in the fourth grade, and there was this group of girls at this table that I called the smart table. All of these girls seemingly came from great families. They seemed to have come from wonderful experiences. They were all so smart. They all got A's on their papers. And I wanted to sit at this table so badly that one year I did some chores, saved all of the money I could find. I don't even know how I got it, but it was a few little dollars that I was able to pull together. And I bought toys for every one of the girls at the table. Why? Because I wanted to sit at the table. Isn't it interesting how we will go out of our way to do things, to perform, to be a part of groups, to sit at tables that God probably didn't even design us to sit at? When I later did further research on the girls at the table, because they didn't accept me at the table, even after I'd given them all of these things, they made me feel like I wasn't good enough. But what I found was that they were cheating together, and that's how they all got A's. So they were copying each other's paper. Their lives and backgrounds wasn't as amazing as I thought it would, that I thought it was. But what it reminded me of is, oftentimes we are trying to squeeze in spaces when the truth is, God has made us greater than the space. He's made us bigger than the table. And I'm grateful of the spaces and the tables that the Lord has closed the doors on so that I would not be able to sit at, because he knew that there was more in me and he was protecting me from things in that spaces. Listen, but rejection, trauma, hurt, and pain can cause you to have a distorted vision of yourself and your identity. I walked away from that experience initially feeling very insecure, feeling very hurt, feeling very rejected, and it began to play on who I thought I was in terms of my identity. Listen, when you have a distorted view on yourself, you ultimately also have a distorted view of others. Can I tell you this? You cannot select well when your vision isn't clear. You cannot select well when your mind isn't sober. And you surely cannot select well when your heart is not healed. Why is this important? This is critically important for us because our inability to understand who we are as individuals, our inability to understand our issues, our challenges, our proclivities, and the root of where we are and where they came from, this and why we have the current connections that we have, this will ultimately distort our ability to choose our crew. It distorts our ability to choose our connections wisely. Some of us call ourselves loners not because we really want to be. If we get to the root of it, it's not because we want to be, but because we have either been hurt, we have either been rejected, or we have been disappointed. And can I tell you what happens? And so it becomes easier to isolate rather than to integrate. What is isolation? Isolation is to cause a person or a place to remain alone or apart from others. To integrate is to bring people or groups together with particular characteristics into an equal participation of a social group or institution. Why? Many of us choose to isolate because it becomes easier to simply be by yourself rather than to engage others. Why? Because you know at the end of the day, you won't disappoint you. You know at the end of the day, you won't let you down. You ultimately know at the end of the day, you're not going to talk behind your own back. And so what happened is we become addicted to isolation, not realizing that the enemy uses this as something that is designed to be a temporary experience. He causes it to turn into a lifestyle for us. Some of you are permanently living in isolation. You have become enamored with cutting people off. You are a master at cutting people off. You've become enamored at being by yourself and putting a wall around your heart because you believe that it's safe, not even realizing that this is not of the Father. Can I tell you that God is a God of community? We serve a God who is a God of community. Matthew 18 and 20 says to us, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them." Listen, Acts 2, 42 through 47 says, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles, and all who believed were together and had all things in common. They were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all and any as need." Listen, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with gladness and generous hearts. Listen, Psalms 133, 1 through 3 says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron." Listen, Romans 12, 4 through 5 says, "For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another." Listen, Romans 15, 5 and 7 says, "May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Jesus Christ, that together you may with one great voice glorify the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ." Listen, I know that you might have a long history with people. I know that you might have been to high school with them, and I think that that's great. I'm not telling you that it's wrong, but what I am saying to you is that you've got to be open to God leading people and bringing people into your life that you would have not ordinarily selected on your own. Can I tell you that real vision requires a crew? Greater levels of faith require partnership. If you are still believing that you can do life on your own, you're wrong. If you are still believing that the vision God gave you for your purpose and your destiny you can fulfill alone, you are not doing it correctly. If you still think, "I don't like people, I don't want to be bothered with people," can I tell you, you are cutting off your own blessing. You've got to understand that this next stage for you involves you being in relationship, divine relationship that you are open to. Listen, number two, I want to highlight this for you. Individual identities and unified resources. These are things that happen. We see this in this text. These three kings came to the table in their own right with their own things. Each brought a table to the table. Everybody had something. Everybody had something to contribute. Nobody came to the table with a deficit. There were no egos. There was no self-importance. There was no self-conceit. seat, but they all had resources to bring to the table. They weren't comparing the resources. They brought the resources because they needed to fight together in order to win this war. Listen, what type of war are you and your crew designed to win together? What type of resources do you and the people that you are connected to bring to the table? And how have you galvanized these resources so that you all win together? You don't have to be the same, but you ought to bring something to the table that helps you grow, that helps you win this war that God has given you assignment to. Do you and your crew have the spirit of discernment? Does discernment rest upon your crew? Are you asking for help from the right people? People who have wisdom, who have a connection with God, who can give you proper information. Proverbs 20:18 says, plans succeed through good counsel. Do not go to war without wise advice. Listen, who's your crew talking to? Who's interceding on behalf of your crew so that you can do what you need to do? Do you have a crew that is willing to dig with you? That's your question. Is your crew willing to dig with you? Do you have a crew who can hear the voice of the Lord and do something ridiculous in faith with you? Listen, will your crew get dirty with you? Will your crew obey with you, even if it means sacrifice? Will your crew pick up a shovel with you? Is your crew willing to dig ditches with you to see the manifestation of God, even when it seems crazy? Listen, because everybody can be there when things are going well, but do you have some people that are riding with you that will see with you in the spirit, in faith, and help you dig even when you don't even know what the outcome is going to be? Are you and your crew digging together? If only one of you and your crew is blessed, if only one of you and your connections is blessed and nobody else is succeeding, I challenge you to go back and look at things, because you should all be growing. You should all be blessed. Not just one person prosperous, but every person in your crew should be prosperous. Listen, when you live your life like this, there's a level of accountability personally that you walk in to ensure that you are your healthiest self, that you can give your absolute best to the people that you are connected to. And then on the other end, there are accountability for the people who are connected to you. Are you the smartest one in your crew? Are you the only person in your crew that's successful? Are you the only person in your crew that's healthy, that has wealth, that has money? If so, you need a new crew, because what that means is that nobody else in your crew will be able to give or contribute on your level. And what that means is that you then become resentful. You then feel drained. You then feel like you're giving but not receiving. You need to be connected with people who are greater than you on some levels, who have things to offer that you might not have even considered. Does that mean that you leave people behind? No, it doesn't. But what it does mean is that you've got to have wisdom in evaluating who is connected to you and why, so that the most is birthed out of your life and that you can help those people who are connected to you birth their absolute best as well. Listen, I could go on and on, but I'm over my time, but I pray that today causes you to go back and look at your connections. Go back and look at who's sitting at the table of your life. I know that we're in a space where we want to invite everybody to the table, and that's great, but there is an innermost part of who you are where those people have to be assigned by God. You can't even think twice about why they're in your life. You know their purpose. You know their design, and you are there in their life for the same reason. So listen, I want you to go back, take a look, do some real internal evaluation. Look at the people around you, the connections around you. Have they come because you chose them out of a healthy space whereby God led you? Or are you engaged in connections? Is your crew dysfunctional because you are dysfunctional? Listen, I love you. I'm praying for you. We are always praying for you. If you want to give, you can do so right now by using the prompts below. And if you want to become a part of this community of faith, come on. We welcome you. We love you. And we do so with open arms. You can join by going to newbirth.org. Have an incredible day.
New Birth. It's that time. time for our 365 virtual celebration. We're giving God all the glory, Sunday, November 8th.
So as a debt-free ministry, can you imagine how much further we would be able to go?
Above tithes and offering worship experience. Let's get in corporate agreement for $500,000 to continue to do the work of the ministry.
I am excited. I got mine ready. So please, please,
pray about your 365 seed and make a pledge today by texting NB365 to 71441 or visit newbirth.org and complete our commitment card. And our 365 line is available for pre-order. Pick up some exclusive custom merch. Supply is limited. Order today. You know where, at Call to Conquer. And pick up the free 365 wristband at our King's Table from 10 a.m. until 12 p.m. or at the Call to Conquer bookstore between 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. on Saturdays in October. Each and every Saturday, our King's Table feeds over 8,000 people. Our volunteers and staff will be serving the community from 10 a.m. until 12 p.m.
Hello, just want to say thank you to New Birth and Pastor Brian. I think this is a great service that you offer to the community, that people who are hurting are able to come get good quality food and learn about how to vote and how to change our community. So I just want to say thank you very much.
If you or anyone you know are in need of free groceries, stop by the Family Life Center from 10 a.m. until 12 p.m. this Saturday.